Hoover is a long way away from the small town of Montrose, where I, a baby boomer, was born and lived the first 23 years of my life. Montreal was a thriving multicultural center, but the town of Montrose was anything but, with its population of 5,000, an isolated location. It consisted of simple folk with a basic education who worked at the town's oil refineries and lived out their lives in their small, unpretentious government houses that were allotted to them after the Second World War as veterans. My grandmother always said that you never know who could be calling when the phone rang and how white she was. I never would have dreamed that I would be having lunch 50 years later with someone I met 50 years ago and clear across the country in Vancouver to boot. Was it really 50 years ago? My God, that's half a century. I shut that thought right to the back of my mind. But the years fell away with that one phone call. I never knew 50 years ago that that day in September would be a day that changed me forever. We never see days like that coming, do we? They come quietly out of nowhere to overwhelm and mold us anew. Yes, there she was, standing at the front of my fifth grade classroom with our teacher, Mrs. Edmonds, waiting for the other children to arrive. My mouth fell open. My eyes grew wide and wider still. I'd never seen anyone Chinese in person before. Yes, really. I was dumbfounded. Her silk embroidered jacket, her embroidered slippers, her exotic hair ornament. Oh, I was smitten. I wanted to look just like her. I wanted to have clothes look like her. Like hers. She wasn't a pretty girl, but on that day, she was the most beautiful girl I had ever seen. I followed Rain's ping around that first week in the school playground. Oh, I so wanted to be her very, very best friend. Ping, can I play with you? Oh, Ping, can I play with you? Ping, can I play with you? I asked, oh, so hopefully. But my hopes were soon crushed as she took up with the most popular girls in class, never even noticing me. But as the most popular girls sometimes are, as Ping told me, a month later, when I found her wandering in the school playground alone, they were tired of playing with the girl from China. Ping had tears in her eyes and her small mouth was tight. But I play with you, I cried excitedly, forgetting all about my previous rejection and disappointment. But Ping shook her head sadly. She would only play with her younger sister after that. I was not to be a friend of hers of any kind. I wanted to know everything about China after that. I asked my grandmother, but she didn't know much about it. Nobody else I knew seemed to know much about it either, except that they were all commies there. So my brother told me, with a superior look on his face. I looked at China in our rule book and read the entries over and over again, never ever growing tired of them. I wanted to cut out the vibrantly colored pictures, but I knew how much trouble I would get in when my brother told on me, so I didn't. King's parents had bought the town dry cleaners from old Mr. Paquette when he retired. So when my grandmother asked me to run and pick up the dry cleaning that summer, I did just that. I ran, hoping to catch a glimpse of King. But I never did. I would hear her brother, and his sister laughing in the small space behind the shop that was their makeshift home, but she never came out to say hello to me. My only consolation was that I would see her when school started again. But when school started, King was not there. I was absolutely devastated. It seems her parents had enrolled King, her sister and brother in Chinese school. No one seemed to even notice her gone or care. Mrs. Davidson, my grandmother's friend, knew everything that went on in our small town, and she would keep my grandmother duly informed. But I never heard anything whispered about King's family when they played cribbage together. I did hear my grandmother talking on the phone one day to someone, and she was telling this person, whoever it was, that everyone in town was outraged over the rise in dry cleaning costs. Their anger was very much directed at King's father. I was beginning to see the swirling undercurrents around King's family, and they were not good. King smiled warmly at me. We were back in the present moment in Vancouver in a Chinese restaurant sharing dim sum. "Thank you," she said. "For what?" I asked, puzzled. "For being so kind," she almost whispered. "People were not kind. You were always kind to me, even when I was mean to you." I wanted to thank her too for opening up a door in my mind, in my life, but the words just couldn't come. I was overcome with sadness for the girl that was gone, for the girl that would never feel that innocent, heart-stopping excitement again, and who was still unaware of life's muddy undergrowth.